Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about LL grammars and recursive descent parsing. So let's get started. So to recap what was also part of last week, let's consider parsing. So suppose you're given a generative grammar and now you want to check whether a given string of characters, the input, to the parser actually is generated by that grammar. So this is the parsing problem. Can the string be generated? And now you might remember still that for arbitrary generative grammars, they induce a recognizable language. So that means that if the string of characters is a sentence in your language, then the parser must halt and say yes, it is indeed a sentence. But if it is not a sentence, then the parser may go haywire and run forever. So in practice, it's a good idea to restrict ourselves to decidable languages. And so for this video, let's restrict ourselves to context-free languages, as those described by BNF. As you may recall also from last week, there is the problem of ambiguity. An ambiguous grammar allows for the same string of characters to be derived by multiple different derivations. And in practice, this is also not very useful, because then what is the derivation that we should pick? So for that, it is also a good idea to restrict ourselves, namely to restrict the possible derivations that we want to generate, and so that there is at most one. So this is the context. Just as a fun reminder, do keep in mind that there are recognizable but undecidable languages. So if you want to write a parser that always terminates for those languages, then you have bad luck. And also keep in mind, even when you restrict yourself to context-free languages, determining whether the grammar is ambiguous itself is a difficult problem. And so that you could phrase a bit more complicated, but it means the same, to check. So it is the case that to check whether a context-free language is unambiguous, this is undecidable. So more formally, if you consider the meta-language of BNF, so BNF itself being a formal language, if you now take the subset of BNF that is unambiguous, well, that subset itself is undecidable. Okay, so we have made some pragmatic restrictions to make our lives easier when we want to implement a parser. So let's get started with that. So our general approach here is to start with an abstract grammar. And this abstract grammar comprises only the essential grammatical constructs. So these are the constructs of, for instance, your programming language that are important to you. And now, if you think of all the possible parse trees in this grammar, you could think of these parse trees as abstracted away from irrelevant notation, such as comments or irrelevant punctuation. So this parse tree is neat and tidy, and we can work with that in the rest of understanding the language. So these parse trees are called abstract syntax trees. But now, it is the case that for these abstract grammars, they are potentially ambiguous. But we don't mind this, because the different derivations, so the different parse trees we could construct, we later intend to give different meaning. But if we want to recognize an input, we better get rid of this ambiguity from the abstract grammar. And so for that purpose, we introduce a special class of grammars. Let's call them LL grammars. And I'll later explain where the LL stands for, but LL grammars are grammars in which we maybe add additional non-terminals that were not present in our abstract grammar, but these non-terminals then properly encode the way we have resolved ambiguity, for instance, by saying certain grammatical constructs have precedence with respect to other grammatical constructs. And if you remember, to resolve ambiguity, we could also use, for instance, association to the left or to the right. So for implementing this in our parser, we may need to introduce additional non-terminals. Now, we may also have to introduce additional terminals, punctuation, to disambiguate the abstract grammar. As soon as we want to parse, then these additional terminals make the parsing job easier. So consider, for example, adding parentheses to your grammar so that you can make the distinction between how the operators are grouped. In the abstract grammar, you don't really need these parentheses because we actually want it to be ambiguous later for it to be simple so that we can give meaning to it. Okay, but the parentheses in the LL grammar allow us to recognize what the intent is of the programmer. Huh? So, for instance, that certain constructs are intentionally grouped. Okay. The problem with LL grammars is if you take them at face value and you let them generate sentences in your language, then these derivations, because of the introduced non-terminals and terminals, may be more complicated than you want. So whenever we do parsing with an LL grammar, the derivation involves more than what we need. So after we have parsed with LL grammars, we want to clean up and tidy up the parse tree so that we obtain an abstract syntax tree. Later on, I will give you an example of this so that you get a clear idea of what is meant by this. Okay, a very important property of LL grammars is that the input you supply steers the way it chooses its derivations, so to say. So that the input directs the derivations that you want to generate. And furthermore, LL grammars are not ambiguous, also kind of a nice property. Okay, and now with these LL grammars, we can easily implement them. And this implementation strategy of building a program that recognizes sentences in a language described by an LL grammar, it's called a recursive descent parser. Nice technique for implementing LL grammars. Good. So let's look at an example. So suppose we start with an abstract grammar representing arithmetical expressions, addition, multiplication, and say numbers. Positive numbers. Okay, so as you may know from the previous week, this abstract grammar is ambiguous. So we want to remove the ambiguity by imposing operator precedence. And furthermore, we also want that the operators associate to a particular direction. Now, the result of, and I will explain later how we can do that, the result of obtaining the LL grammar from this abstract grammar shows, it looks like this. So the LL grammar that you obtain after you have analyzed the abstract grammar and removed ambiguity is the one shown right now. So you can see that the same non-terminal expr is present, but we have introduced many new non-terminals like expr prime and m expr. And what do they stand for? Well, let's think of m expr for the multiplicative part of the grammar and the p expr for the primitive part. And also there, in the primitive part, you see that we have added additional terminals, the parentheses, so that we can disambiguate the input, so that you know what is grouped to what. Okay, so it's not clear yet how we have obtained this LL grammar, but let's just work out how we can parse. How can we derive strings using this LL grammar? This gives you already an intuitive idea why having these LL grammars is useful in the first place. So suppose that our goal with this LL grammar is to parse the following input. Eh? So we have 2 plus 3 times 4. As you know, we apply here the precedence rules of arithmetic, so the times precedes over the plus. So that means that we prefer to group 3 times 4 and not 2 plus 3. And the plus is done later, so we first group the times. So that is also what we then expect if we derive using our LL grammar that this ambiguity is no longer present. Okay, so let's start our derivation. So we begin with the start symbol expr, and then there is no choice. Huh? So we expand it into the multiplicative expression and the expression prime. Now for LL grammars, it is nice that we don't have to choose which non-terminal we want to replace. If you remember, you see the non-terminal, you replace it by the right-hand side of the rule. So this you don't have to do anymore. You can just choose the first that occurs in your string of symbols. So in this case, we can expand mExpr. And mExpr is pExpr and mExpr prime. So then if we replace this one by the right-hand side, we obtain this string. Okay. And then next, the first non-terminal is pExpr. So that one we can also expand. Now here we have made a choice, namely we have chosen pExpr to expand to the number, right? And why? Because, well, input directed, so we can already sort of peek into the string that we're intending to parse, and we have already seen, hey, there is a number here, so this sounds like a good choice. Okay, so when we have made the choice to go to the number, we can then, I skip some steps here for parsing numbers, but okay, so we have recognized that 2 is indeed a number. So then the next non-terminal is the mExpr prime. Now, if you look at its definition, it expects a times symbol, or it can be removed, because here we have the empty string, the epsilon symbol that stands for the empty string. So if you now look at the input, we have already recognized 2, but the next symbol is the plus. And the plus does not occur in our choices, so we can already know, okay, well, let's go for the empty then, because maybe another non-terminal further down the line can recognize the plus. So that is also what we do. This mExpr prime, we choose the epsilon, so we delete it. And then we get the following. Okay, so moving it upwards a little bit. So we now have still recognized 2. We're currently at the plus symbol. And the only non-terminal, so the first non-terminal we can now expand, is expr prime. So looking at expr prime, it indeed starts with the plus on one of its choices. Or it is empty. Eh? So if we look at our input, we can sort of make a reasonable guess what we want to choose. We want to choose the plus. Okay, so let's expand it that way. So we expand the plus and we have a new non-terminal, namely the expr we want to have at that place. Okay, so then we can expand. There's no choice to make with, again, an mExpr and expr prime. Now we continue with the first non-terminal, so that's this one here. And if you look at the right-hand side, fine, we can just replace it by it. Eh? So mExpr is replaced again by the right-hand side. And then we obtain this string, which all seems fine. Again, we look at the first non-terminal, pExpr. And now to make the choice between these two, we can already peek into the string that we want to parse. Hey, I see a 3 here. So it's a good idea to make the choice num. Okay, and then the number is then parsed and we recognize the 3. So then the next non-terminal is mExpr prime. And if you look at it, we again have a choice. Now, since we have already recognized 3, the next symbol in our input string is the times. And we can make a reasonable choice now, because hey, here we see also times starts at this particular choice. Fine, so we expand this into the first alternative. So then, oh yeah, if we clean it up a bit, we expand it. Okay, so then we have 2 plus 3 times, That's this times here now, huh? And then another mx per. So we then expand the mx per, again by px per and mx per prime. The px per, we have to make a choice, but again, we can peek into the input string. We see a 4, so we can choose number here. So we do that, and the number is recognized to be 4. So now we are at the end of the input string, but we still have two non-terminals left. But if you look at mx per prime, we can make a choice to make it empty. So we can delete mx per prime. And if you now look at x per prime, that is remaining after after we have deleted mx per prime, then again we can make a choice. And here also there is the empty string, so we can also delete that one. And then we have obtained a sentence. So this is just an example how we can parse with LL grammars. Okay. So now think of the parse tree that we have made by taking this derivation. It actually is quite complicated. Here you see it. Right? So we started with expr, which was expanded into these two. So whenever you expand a non-terminal, we draw the lines. And then we went on the left, and we expanded mexpr, we expanded pexpr, and then the number was recognized to be a 2. This mxpr was empty, so it was removed. And then we continued with the expr prime, which was recognized to make a choice by seeing, it had to make, we looked at the plus, etc., etc., etc. So maybe if you pause the video and go back to the previous slides, you can maybe see how this parse tree corresponds to the derivation you have just seen. Okay, but I mean, you can already see that with these LL grammars, these parse trees are quite complicated. And why are they quite complicated? Because we have introduced new non-terminals that were not present in our original abstract grammar. And so which terminals and which non-terminals do we want to keep? Well, let's make them red. And those were the terminals and non-terminals that were intended to be in our grammar, in our abstract grammar. And all the other stuff you see in this parse tree was added to resolve ambiguities. Okay, so we now can simplify the parse tree. Right, so how do we simplify it? Well, we could, for instance, remove all the irrelevant non-terminals that were only there present for parsing. And then we obtain this a little bit more simplified parse tree. And now you can already see a bit more the structure of what will eventually become our abstract syntax tree. And that looks like this. So if I go back a slide again, you see that this expr is related to the plus symbol here. So this is a addition you can think of. And then the left argument is the number 2. And then the right argument is another expression, a sub-expression, of which its left argument was the 3. It was the multiplication operation, and its right argument was 4. And so that is also what you then obtain in the abstract syntax tree. In the abstract syntax tree, the nodes are labeled by the grammatical construct, and then you have an ordered list of sub-expressions. And in this case, we have as leaf the number, so this is the 2. And then as another subtree here, we have the operation times with the leaves 3 and 4. Now you can imagine that if we used the brackets, and this is maybe an interesting exercise, if we use the brackets around 2 plus 3 and then did times 4, can you then imagine how the abstract syntax tree looks like after we have obtained the complicated parse tree from the LL grammar, from deriving with the LL grammar, and then we have performed the simplification? Well, then you would likely see that the plus would be below, right? So that the 2 and the 3 are under the plus, which then sits under the times. And so by changing the brackets we have introduced to resolve ambiguities, you can then get different kinds of abstract syntax tree eventually. Okay, so that that is a demonstration of how this works. Now let's think a little bit more about the properties of LL grammars. Why are LL grammars so interesting and so practical? Okay, well, one of the things that LL grammars are really suitable for is so-called leftmost, finding the leftmost derivation. And a good strategy for finding the leftmost derivation is if you expand always the leftmost non-terminal in your current string. And while you're deriving, you have a current string. If you have take the leftmost non-terminal and expand that according to the grammar, then you will find a derivation in that way. But there is a problem with that, because this is not always productive for all grammars. And what do I mean with productive? Well, this does not always lead you to a string that only consists of terminals. So you can get sort of stuck in always expanding non-terminals, generating more non-terminals, while never reaching the goal of a string that consists only of terminals. And this is caused, this improductivity, this is caused by expanding and expanding and expanding and never getting closer by to your goal of your input string that you wanted to derive. So, how can we solve that? Well, no, that's for later. First, an example of why this is not productive. Consider this grammar. We have the non-terminal A, you have two alternatives. Either you have A plus A, or you have num. Well, then we start with the non-terminal A, and we expand the leftmost, so that is just A itself. And, well, let's suppose we make a choice to go into the first alternative. Well, and then we again expand the leftmost, and then we get another A plus A. And so how can you now know when you have to stop this expansion process? If you do it naively, you just get this this indefinite expansion where you will never see what terminal is there. And so you don't make any progress. But this is an example of direct left recursion, right? And why is it called left recursion? Because there is an alternative in which the same non-terminal that we try to match with the input string, or which from which we try to derive the input string, occurs on the leftmost position. So that means that whenever we keep on expanding, never going to stop. We always can keep expanding this way. But that's direct left recursion. There is also this thing called indirect left recursion, in which you not directly expand into the non-terminal again, but you go intermediary through some other non-terminal, in this case B. So if you look at this grammar here, A, we have two choices. So let's say we take the first choice. Then for B, we also have two choices. And if we also there take the first choice, then we're back at A again. And this you can also do indefinitely. So whenever you have a grammar which has this, that on the on one of its alternatives, it is possible that then again on one of its alternatives, you reach back to the same non-terminal, always if taking the first non-terminal and expanding it, and then we're getting the same loop. Then we get the same indefinite expansion again. So this is called indirect left recursion. But is it possible, because we could express our grammar this way, is it now possible to eliminate this left recursion? And so that we can practically work with it. Yes, you can remove left recursion, and I will show you how to remove direct left recursion. So that was this example where you immediately see that we have this loop. So for direct left recursion, we can eliminate it by inspecting the rules. So suppose that we have a direct recursive rule, left recursive rule A. So then it has the shape that the A non-terminal has a number of alternatives. And some of those alternatives immediately start again with an A. But other of the alternatives, let's call them the betas, they do not immediately begin with the non-terminal A. Right? So if the alternative starts immediately with the non-terminal A, then the remainder, let's say, are the alphas. So suppose that we now found a rule that has this shape, and then the grammar is direct left, then the grammar has a direct left recursive rule, and now we want to get rid of that rule. So what can we do then? Well, we could replace this rule, So this rule that we have found in our grammar, we could replace that by two rules. And one rule still is for the non-terminal A, but we now introduce a new non-terminal, which let's call it A prime. And the intuition here is that in A, we could have perfectly matched these betas. We could have made progress by recognizing our input stream when we made the choice in the betas. But whenever we take a choice that starts with an A, and we always try to expand the first occurring non-terminal, then these are not productive. They will lead you to an infinite loop. So if you now think of, well, what could have been in the position of these A's? Well, these A's could have been the betas. And the betas could have been productive and resolved into a string of terminals, say. Okay, so that's the main idea here. So we first do the betas, and then we still afterwards, we check, hey, do we then have something that matches the alphas? So the alphas here are what remains after the A originally. But alternatively, we could also just have the beta and nothing. If you have originally made this alternative, there is nothing behind it. So that is why the A prime also additionally has as an alternative the empty string. So you could remove the A prime if it was not needed, because immediately you could match with these betas. Now the question is, why are then the alpha prime, or the A primes after these alphas? Well, think of it. So we have this A, but the A could match with a beta, or it could match with a beta and then an alpha, and then an alpha, right? So if we then have recognized first the beta, that's the productive part, then we want to consume many more alphas. One of those choices afterwards, because that's also possible to derive if the rule looks like this. Okay, but this argument might sound a little bit abstract, but this is an exercise for you. Try to perform, first give an abstract grammar where you see you have left recursion in one of the rules. Now do this left recursion, direct left recursion elimination, and try to argue that the result generates precisely the same strings as your original grammar would. And then you might see clearly why, for instance, you need this A prime here. Okay, but that's left as an exercise. So that's left recursion, or is it? No, we also had this indirect left recursion. Well, it turns out that also indirect left recursion can be eliminated from a grammar, but that's a little bit more complicated than I can describe on one slide. So let's not go into those details. In the book of Sebesta, you will find a reference to a research article in which you can find more about that. But that's a little bit too complicated for now. So let's not deal with that. So let's keep our grammar simple and only deal with left recursion, direct left recursion. Okay, then another thing of LL grammars, another property specifically of LL grammars, is that we have to use the input. It's an input directed process, so we have to use the input to make choices among alternatives in rules. But how can we make these choices now? Maybe it's a good idea to show you an example. Suppose that the grammar looks like this. We have the non-terminal A, which could either be a plus of a B on the left-hand side and an A on the right-hand side, or A could immediately be a number. But then the B, the left side of the plus, there's no choice, but it starts also with a number. So whenever we now peek into our input string and we see a number, then how can we make this choice between these two alternatives? That's a bit difficult. Now, to understand the problem a bit, we can understand this a bit more formal, in a more formal way. And so what intention is our LL grammar has to be of such a shape that by peaking the input string that we were given in the parsing process, by looking at that, we can already anticipate which choice we want to make. Well, this only works if somehow we can, from looking at the input, we can see, oh, well, now we have to make this alternative. Oh, otherwise we have to make that alternative. That is not possible if these alternatives somehow overlap with respect to non-terminals that they would accept. To make that a bit more precise, consider first to be a function that is defined on, say, a string of symbols, non-terminals and terminals. And first, it consists precisely of the set of terminals that are allowed as the first terminal in what it can recognize. Or it can include the empty string, so that it can also recognize the empty string. So to give you a bit of an example, let's illustrate it using this grammar on that you see. So what is then first of the first alternative? So we can compute now first by looking at B plus A. Well, so B plus A, what do we do? Well, we take, we want to expand B, and B is num times A. Well, and then what is then the potential first terminal that we will recognize? Well, that depends on what is in num. And num are the numbers. So then if you see a 0 or a 1 or 2, etc., up to a 9, then you know that, well, this alternative could be taken. This alternative is fine. If your input string starts with a number, yeah, then this alternative is perfectly fine to take, because you know that if you expand B, well, and B starts with num, it will accept that. Okay, but now it turns out that first of the second alternative is also a num, so that's also 0, 1, 2, etc. until 9. So now whenever you look at the input and you have to make a choice what to generate here with A, you can't call it input directed, because the input does not say to you which alternative you have to choose. So a bit more formally, what we can see here is that this first set of the first alternative and the first set of the second alternative, they overlap. And precisely because they overlap, because they both recognize the same terminals, first terminals when you do derivation from these alternatives, you cannot make a choice. You cannot know which alternative you have to choose based only on the input. So LL grammar, you can now think of, okay, how can we turn this into an LL grammar? Because in an LL grammar, we have the property that we must be able from the input to make these choices. But in this grammar, we cannot make the choice. So what can we then do? Well, we can introduce new non-terminals and we can reshape and transform the grammar itself so it is in a proper shape. And then we can make it into an LL grammar. Okay, so what you can already see is, what if we now take this B, it stands for num times A, and plug it in the B here. So we sort of simplify the grammar a bit. Well, then you obtain this, right? So here we have taken where originally was B and already took its right-hand side and replaced B by it. So we here eliminated the production rule. But now immediately it becomes clear, why is there a problem? Because in the alternative between the left and the right, you see both start with a number. So we don't know yet how to make a choice here. So what you can see is they have a common prefix. Both start with a number. So what if we now extract this common prefix and delay the choice until after we have recognized the number? And that is how you can transform it. So you see, both of the choices start with a number. Let's do that first and delay the choice of the alternative to later. Well, that we can do by introducing a new non-terminal, let's say A prime, and in A prime we make the choice. So now A first recognizes a number, and then we will look at A prime, a newly introduced non-terminal. And in A prime, we can make the choice. right? A prime, if we see in the input stream times, well, then we know we have to make the left choice. And if we see nothing, so the input string is already at the end, well, then we know that we can make that choice. Okay. For A now, you don't have a choice because we have delayed it. But now, whenever we reach whenever num is expanded and recognizes a number, then we continue with A prime, and now we have to make a choice. But now look at the first set of its alternatives. Well, what is the first terminal that you recognize in the first alternative? Well, that must be this times symbol. So this first set associated to the first alternative is times. But then what is the first set of the second alternative? Well, it's just the empty string. And times and the empty string, well, they do not overlap. Eh? They don't share any terminals. So there is no confusion to be made here. Okay. So we can now make the choice based on looking at the input. That's a good thing. So in general, for an LL grammar, for a grammar to be an LL grammar, we want the rules to lack left recursion, right? Because that allows us to be productive. Otherwise, we get potentially in this infinite loop if we always expand the leftmost non-terminal. And furthermore, we want it to be input directed. So for that, we can check whether all the alternatives, we can make whenever we want to look at want to expand a particular non-terminal, we want to be able to make the choice based on the input. And to make that choice, we can require all these alternatives to have different terminals that they consume, that the first terminals that they match in the input string. And that can be set by, okay, all the pairs of alternatives must be disjoint with respect to their first terminal set. Okay. So, now why is it called an LL grammar? Well, an LL grammar, it scans the input string that you supply from the left to the right. And so it starts with the first non-terminal that is in the input string. And then it goes on from the left to right. Now, furthermore, the grammar, it generates the leftmost derivation. So it always expands the leftmost non-terminal that you're working with. And it furthermore has another property. And this property is a little bit more complicated. This is called determinism. So a grammar... An LL grammar must be not having any of these left recursive rules. You must be able to make these choices by looking at the first set, so that you have a pairwise disjointness. And furthermore, the grammar has to be deterministic. Now, and deterministic is a kind of a technical definition, but I'll try to make it clear by giving you an example later. But when is the grammar deterministic? Now, suppose that you have some kind of derivation, since you do leftmost derivations, we can at some point expect that we have already consumed from the input string a number of terminals, and that then we have a leftmost non-terminal. So the leftmost non-terminal in our current string, so we're not done yet with the derivation, but in our current string, in the derivation process, the leftmost terminal, let's say it's A, and then there must be some prefix, potentially empty prefix, of non-terminals before, of terminals before it. And there is some suffix, beta, we don't give, we don't care about that. So given such a derivation, then it must always be the case that if you can then derive from this situation two possible continuations, so suppose you consume an input from the input stream, a terminal D with some remainder gamma, which could also include non-terminals, then if this is the case, this can only be the case when at the rule of A, whenever you expand A, there is a unique choice to make. And this is not always the case. even if it does not have left recursion, and even if you check that all the alternatives are disjoint pairwise, it still requires you to reason why the grammar is deterministic before you can call it an LL grammar. And for that, let's look at an example, then this definition also becomes a little bit more clear. So here you have a grammar. And the question is this grammar LL? Well, for that, we must lack direct or indirect left recursion. Well, and that is the case, right? Because S does not immediately start with S, and there is no way, because it has a terminal, and a terminal here, so that's fine. S is not left recursive, and the same thing applies to A and B. B obviously is not recursive, there is no non-terminal, and the A, well, it always consumes a terminal, so there is not immediately the A or indirectly an A in the first position. So fine, the first condition applies here. It is not left recursive. The second condition is that for all the rules, the alternatives must be pairwise disjoint with respect to the first terminal that they would recognize. Well, in S, the first alternative finds an A in the input string, the second alternative finds a B in the input string, or we have the empty string. So that those are all disjoint. And also for A, if you see here, the A is the A terminal is separate from the B terminal, so that's also disjoint. So that means that whenever we scan the input from the left to right, then whenever we encounter the rule A, it supposedly allows us to then say, well, we can make a choice based on the input, right? Well, is that so? So then consider the following derivation. And this derivation might explain to us why this is not an LL grammar, because is it deterministic? Is this grammar deterministic? Okay, so let's give it the input string BBAABA. So the starting symbol, by the way, is S. So if we start deriving from the starting symbol S, well, we can make a choice between the A, B, or empty branch alternative. Sorry, and we can obviously, because the input string starts with B, we can choose BA, right? So we go from S to BA. This is an input-directed choice. Fine. Next, the leftmost non-terminal is A, and A has two choices. Either it starts with an A or it starts with a B. So if we look then at the remainder of the input string, we see a B, so we can also make that choice. So this A is then replaced by BAA. So now we continue with the leftmost non-terminal, that is this A. And this A, we can make an input-directed choice. So we look at this A here, and we can say, well, for this A, we expand it by AS. Sure, so we now have BBA, and then S, and then an A. Now the leftmost symbol is again the S. But this time in the S, we can make an input-directed choice. The next terminal in our input is this A here, so we make the choice in S to be this AB. Fine, so we replace this S by this AB. Okay, so far so good. And now this B here, again input-directed, it must be a B. There is also a B in the input, so this B is then replaced by this terminal B. Then the leftmost non-terminal is this A. Well, the leftmost non-terminal, we can again make an input-directed choice. The input that remains is this A. So we can choose this alternative because it starts with an A. So this A is then replaced by AS. And now finally, because the input here is at the end, we can say, okay, well, for this S here, let's choose the empty. Because there is nothing else to match. So then we have generated BBAABA, and that was also our input string. So yes, we can say this is in our language, it parses all fine. But now consider an alternative derivation. That's this. So the first steps are the same. So we go from S to BA to BBAA, and then to BBASA. And remember, we made a choice here. So we made a choice here, S, to expand by looking at the input to AB. But S also has an empty alternative. So we could have made the choice alternatively to remove S in this case. And if we remove S in this case, then we get BAA, BBA, and then the non-terminal A. And then if you look at the non-terminal A, we can make again an input-directed choice. And so here we say A, because that's in the input, so then we generate AS. So we replace this A here by AS here. Then we can again look at the S. And the S, we can make an input-directed choice because we here have a B remaining. So we choose the BA, so that this S is replaced by BA. And then we can look at A, okay? And A, we make an input-directed choice. We have this A and then S. So this A non-terminal is replaced by the terminal A and the non-terminal S. And then since we have reached the end of the input string, we match this empty string. So both are derivations of the same string. So this violates the property of being deterministic. Because look at here, right? We have some prefix, BBA, and then the leftmost non-terminal is S. Yeah, so this is the same in both cases. And then, if we continue the derivation a little bit further, we now see that after we have made after we have consumed A from our input string, so here we have A and here we have A, it turns out that we had made a different choice for S, because here we made choice to consume AB, non-terminal B, but in this derivation we made choice to make S empty and then choose A. The remainder A that then becomes the leftmost non-terminal, which would expand to AS. So to go back a little bit to the definition of determinism, so here you see for any derivation with a prefix and the firstmost non-terminal, it must be the case that if there are two derivations of the same non-terminal that follows the prefix, then there must have been a unique choice we made at A. But that is not the case here, because we could make a different choice what we do there. So this is not an LL grammar. Okay, so this discussion might be a little bit complicated, but in practice, pragmatics, there is a very useful trick to avoid this problem, and that's called a greedy parser. So a parser is greedy if as soon as it sees that there is still input available and one of its alternatives match that input, then it takes it. So then in our case, the first derivation saw, hey, there was an A available in our input, so let's expand S to take that choice. The greedy parser always takes that choice if it's available. So it's greedy because it wants to consume as much input as possible. And so it prefers taking the input, and it only delays this empty whenever there is no other possibility in the input. And if your parser does that, then it's called a greedy parser. And so this then removes the ambiguity, because the other derivation where we removed S, that one is not taken. Because indeed we had an alternative, if you go back here, in this situation where we had BBAS, we know that in the input the A was available. So we prefer taking this alternative and we ignore the empty. We only take the empty whenever there's no other choice. And then it makes you a greedy parser. So to give you an example of a greedy LL grammar, so I basically say it's a greedy LL grammar if it satisfies the properties that it has no left recursion and that it has the property that you can always make a choice between the alternatives. And by making it greedy, we also resolve this deterministic problem, because now we can't make a choice. We prefer one derivation over the other, so there's no ambiguity anymore. So, okay, But you might then complain, this is not an LL grammar, because it's not left recursive. Eh? Because it is left recursive, sorry. There is the rule B, the non-terminal B, which immediately has a non-terminal B in one of its alternatives. Well, it's an exercise to remove this left recursion, and you can do that. Eh? The direct left recursion can be removed using the trick explained in the previous slide, a few slides back. Okay, so let's assume that we have resolved this left recursion. Then now, how does this greedy LL parser work? Now consider the input string. We have some variable x, and then we have plus, 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 and then a number 24. Now, what you would expect from the grammar is, hey, we have this plus here, and we have this plus, plus here. Right. So whenever we go into this B, so we start with the starting symbol S, and we derive the leftmost, we continue the derivation in the leftmost non-terminal, then in the leftmost non-terminal, if it's greedy, then we want to take as much plus pluses as possible that are in the input string. But then, that might be one of the possibilities. But then we never end up with the plus on the outer level on top. Eh? Because if we take plus plus and then another plus plus, then we see a 24 as a remainder of the input string. While at the top level of S, we expect a single plus to remain. And we somehow need to make a choice now. And the greedy one takes the plus plus as much as possible. But the potential other derivation, if we didn't have the greedy grammar, would be that we take plus plus and then interpret this plus to be on the top level and to interpret this plus as indicating that the number is positive. And so then you get a parenthesized version. It would be x plus plus, and then we want to take a plus, and the number should be positive, so it should be grouped like this. But this is not recognized by the greedy parser. The greedy parser just takes the pluses, and then it sees another plus plus, so it takes that one as well, and then it leads to a parse error, because then whenever it is done consuming the input, so B is done, it's done consuming the input here, so we take then the empty, after resolving the left recursion, then we take the empty alternative, because no of the other alternatives is possible, then we return to the top level S, and we expect a plus, but there is no plus in the input. There is only 24. So this would then lead to a parse error. And now this example might look a little bit contrived, but actually it turns out in practice, parsers are implemented in this greedy manner. Eh? So for instance, in the Java programming language, you can also see that this plus plus is greedily consumed from the input. And this is described, this problem and the solution to it is described in this Stack Overflow post. And now in practice, if you want to have the parser to accept this as this, you can put spaces in between of the pluses so that you then have plus plus space plus space plus 24. And then in the lexical analysis stage of your parser, which transforms your character string into a token string, you can take the plus plus and convert it into a single token. And you take the individual plus, which is separated by spaces from the previous plus plus, and turn that one into a separate token. And since then, the parser then can make a choice. Do I have a plus or do I have a plus plus? These choices can be made more easily, and you can actually construct an LL grammar that way. Okay, but this is a nice. This is just a nice case explaining you that this topic it goes into quite depth. It goes quite deep. This parsing stuff. Just to recap, summarize what I've been talking about all along. So, if you want to implement an abstract grammar, so that you obtain a parser that can look at input and then decide, yes, it's part of the language, and obtain a nice abstract syntax tree, or otherwise reject it and give a parse error, well, then you start with an abstract description of a grammar that comprises only the essential grammatical constructs. but it may have some ambiguity in it. So then to remove the ambiguity, you associate the, so you order the constructs according to a certain precedence. Yeah? So certain grammatical constructs group more, there is more preference to group certain grammatical constructs than others. This already removes a little bit of ambiguity. Then to remove further ambiguity, you can then resolve their association, huh? So whether the binary operators associate to the left or to the right. And by the way, LL grammars are really well suited for left associativity, because it's also the leftmost derivation that it generates, so that really works well. And then, then you have an LL grammar by, okay, you have ordered the constructs, you have resolved their associativity, you remove left recursion, you make sure that for all the alternatives there is a choice. And then to get rid of this non-deterministic, this non-determinism, later on you say, okay, let's do it greedily. And then you have a greedy LL grammar. Okay. Now, the implementation of this LL grammar can be done using recursive descent. And recursive descent is basically an implementation strategy. So if you know you have an LL grammar, then you can implement it using a recursive descent parser. So a recursive descent parser basically consists of two parts. Eh? You have the tokenizer that analyzes the character string and already groups together characters into tokens to make later on the grammatical analysis a little bit easier. You've seen the example with the plus plus and the plus. And the tokenizer, okay, it inputs a string of characters and then it produces a string of tokens. And now in practice, the tokenizer works on the fly, but you can also do it step by step. Eh? So first analyzing the string and producing a token string, but then you have to keep that also in memory. So certain implementations do it on the fly because that requires less memory. Nowadays, that's no longer an issue, but when all these techniques were developed, machines had lesser memory available, so it was a concern. Now, tokenizers typically allow you to have the to allow you to peek or to look ahead a little bit in the input string, and this is necessary so that you can make the choices of the alternatives. And whenever you want to look at non-terminal, what alternative should I take? You want it to be input directed, and for that the tokenizer allows you to peek. But now peeking, it is sort of an operation that does not consume the token, and consuming means, okay, I have now taken the token from the token stream and it is definitely accepted by the parser. So peeking is only cursory. Does it potentially, does it have this non-terminal? No. Okay, well then I'll leave it in place. But while consuming says, okay, I consume it from the tokenizer, and so that definitely means that my generate, so that the string that I generate, the prefix becomes longer that way. So now the recursive descent parser, what you do is for each of the non-terminal, you create a procedure. And these procedures typically can call each other recursively. Yeah? That's why it's called a recursive descent parser, because each non-terminal is associated to a procedure. And to implement this leftmost derivation, you basically, each time you encounter non-terminal in your grammar, you just call another procedure, and then this leads to recursive calls. Now the control flow of this procedure calling is basically following this leftmost derivation. So then if you think of this, then why is that the grammar is not productive an issue? Well, then you get this infinite recursive calling, and then eventually you get a Stack Overflow. And then I don't mean the website, but actually that your machine crashes. So that's why this left recursion should be eliminated. Now, during the parsing process, you could already simplify the parse tree, because it's only calling procedures, but it doesn't do anything yet. And one of the outputs of your recursive descent parser could be, for instance, an abstract syntax tree. So you create some structures in memory and that you decorate with information that you obtain from the input string. And so you could construct an abstract syntax tree while you are parsing the input string. And then when you reach the end of the input string and no errors occurred, and so you're certain that the grammar accepts the string, then you can say, okay, here's the abstract syntax tree associated to the input string. While if you encounter an error during this recursive descent parsing, you just throw an error, or you crash, or you exit the program. You might print some error messages explaining to the user what the parser expected, but what was present in the input string, which didn't really coincide. Eh? Okay, and so to give you finally a little bit of an idea how the code looks like, so here you have an LL grammar on the screen, and now we associate to each of the non-terminals a procedure. So for instance, in Java or C++ or a C-like language, you could imagine, okay, assume that we have a tokenizer with the functions peak and consume. Then peak is basically looking at the next token and leaves it in place, while consume basically moves, say, an index to the next one, or on the fly produces the next token, right? So that the next peak works. So then each of these non-terminals are associated to the procedures with the same name. Eh? The prime is replaced by a one here. And as you can see, we can use sequential composition to implement the string of non-terminals. So we every non-terminal on the right-hand side becomes a call, and that is then recursively called. In our case, for instance, the expression can call the M expression, which can call M express 1, which then, the expression calls M expr, and when that one returns, that it calls expr 1. And that one, if it is indeed the case that the token string consists as a next symbol, a plus, in the input string, then we will consume that token, the plus, and we can recursively call exp again. So that's how you then get this recursion. You should be aware that there is often a recursion limit. So how deep can you call functions? The call stack can be limited by a number of procedures that you call. So this recursive descent basically cannot parse very, very long strings that way. But for most strings and in practice, it's actually a very nice technique of implementing parsers. Okay, so that's LL grammars and recursive descent parsing. Thank you for watching this video, and hope to see you soon again.